Welcome to the 10 Pin Bowling Show. This week we have a Baker Teams match between 10 Pin City and Inter Bowl. Now down to our commentators.
Thank you, Simon, and welcome to all viewers to this week's edition of the 10 Pin Bowling Show. We're covering the 2010 New South Wales State League Big Clash, coming to you from 10 Pin City, Lidcombe, New South Wales. As we introduce the 10 Pin City team, number one's Glenn Rowland, two at Jason Osborne, Andrew Lloyd at three, Matt Riley at four, and their anchor bowler, Glenn Loader.
And for Team Interbowl, we have Kevin Webb, Christian Perdue, Sam Cooley, Daniel Webb, and Dale Fitzgerald.
Thanks, Brenton. And as the standings currently sit, Interbowl lead, 10 Pin City, 3 versus 2. Lead-off bowler for 10 Pin City is Matt Riley. See his first shot.
That one went just a little bit long. Looked like he might have got that a bit too far inside, and it held the oil a bit long.
Not a bad opening shot from Matt Riley, folks. We're in for a bit of a treat today. We don't see this on TV very often. Actually, this would be the first time. But we are bowling in Baker format, which means every member of the team takes it in turns to have a shot, and their combined score will take the team point. Matt Riley closes out the spare nicely.
Goes coast to coast with the spare, which is a little bit unusual. Now, young Daniel Webb, the youngest player out of the 10 in this competition. And he's just got a little bit of early pressure. See how he handles it.
Okay. Oh. Take the nine. Looked a bit tentative on the first shot.
Yeah, I think that was a little bit of a nervous one, that one. Way inside the target. Crossed over for a high Brooklyn hit. Leaves for six pin. Goes back with the plastic ball for the spare and makes it easily. That'll help calm the nerves a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. The nerve settler. And being a 10-frame match, each bowler potentially has two frames to bowl to themselves. And that's one out of the way. Now, Jason will have his shot. Crosses over and carries all 10. Jason Osborne starting with a strike.
Player's just looking a little bit tentative at the moment, just wanting, after seeing Matt go light the first frame. I think the next couple of guys have just been trying too hard to make sure that the ball gets to the pocket, and as a result, they've been crossing over.
Sam Cooley, another one of the bowlers with a high rev rate. Travels through the centre of the lane, gets a bit of hold, carries all 10, well done.
It was a nice, clean, crisp shot, that one. As you see there in the graphic, all 10 on the pit.
We're going to see quite a bit of the lane oil breaking down or travelling towards the back of the lane. As we have 10 different bowlers throwing 10 different lines, it would be interesting to see.
A PBA washout for Glenn Rowland there. And looked like he got a little bit quick with the feet, and as a result just didn't get any leverage. He was late with the timing, no leverage. Missed a little bit to the right, and the ball just never recovered. This is very tough. Two ways to go about this particular spare.
I'd say he went for the second of the two. It's trying to fit the ball between the one and the six pin and taking care of each side alternatively. Or you can throw at the 1-2 pocket and try and throw that head pin into the 6-10 combination.
Dale Fitzgerald now looking to help Interbowl get out to a big lead. 27 years old, 4 300s in his career, and averages 215 in league, so that's not too shabby.
And this for a huge advantage. See what he can do. Oh, gets the tap out of the gutter. Nice bit of fortuitous carry there. Just had enough energy to rock it out. And that's a double now for Team Interbowl. Huge advantage.
Huge. Love that. And our only lefty. See what Andrew can do.
You would think Andrew Lloyd, he would have a bit of an advantage being the lone left-hander on this pair. He has numerous titles to his name. Throwing a nice pocket there, but leaving a 7-pin. No opportunity to throw the 300 game on this format, but he does have 21 to his credit, so he knows how to throw the ball.
Yeah, just a lazy 21 300 games.
Just a lazy 21. In his home centre too. You couldn't get much more going your way, could you?
There you go. Has the plastic spare ball out. He's going to go hard and straight at the 7-pin.
Yeah, it's a good example of a spare. He didn't like it off the hand, but had enough to cover it.
It's the beauty of using the plastic ball. You can miss a couple of boards inside, and you're still going to make the spare, whereas if you go at that with the reactive and a little bit of hand, miss inside, you've got no hope.
Now Kevin Webb steps up to the plate for Enderbowl. It's their number four bowler.
Far and away the most experienced player in this field.
And crossing over again, leaving a 6-pin there. He has an impressive resume, Kevin Webb. He's bowled 16 perfect 300 games. A high four-game series of 1,047. It's a lazy 260 average over four. He's been bowling for 38 years and has a league average of 222.
Again, the plastic ball to shoot the single pin. No problem.
Nicely done there. Kevin is also the father of Daniel Webb, who has led off for Interbowl. So first father-son combination I think we've had here on the 10-pin bowling show.
That's correct.
Now here comes a very, very experienced campaigner, Glenn Loader. He's throwing the extreme inside and gets a nice hold and equal carry. Lovely shot there.
Have a look at this one. Just gets the read at the right time. Perfect angle of entry. 10 in the pit.
Yeah, he's got great ball speed for his type of shot.
Matches up very, very nicely indeed. Christian Perdue now. The anchor bowler for Interbowl. Very experienced player.
Oh. It's a good solid pocket hit. Break point maybe just a tad late. Sent that 6-pin whizzing around the 10. Would not have taken much of an adjustment at all for that to be gone. But he's going to go back, pick up the plastic ball, and shoot hard and straight at the 10. Yeah, don't see too many spares of that calibre being missed. We'll be right back after this short break.
Andrew does not make a spare, at least a good spare, and a good count in this frame, Jason can bag out and win. What happens here? Oh. That's the match right there. What a great shot under the gun.
Yeah,
it's seen a huge lead being eroded away by Jason's good bowling and his own mistakes, but that was it was just a good, aggressive shot. Didn't leave anything in the bank on that one.
Pretty much the lockout shot here. Oh, and what a shot. 10-pin falls late. And I think the 2008 SA Cup is going to the man from the Northern Territory, Andrew MacArthur.
Deadly consistent bowler is Max Stewart. He's leaving a 10-pin there, but it really doesn't matter at this stage. He's taking nothing away from him. He's bowled fantastically all week. He's thrown a 297 in the semi-finals.
That's right.
You know, you can't take that away from him.
That certainly gave everyone a bit of a thrill. We thought we might have our first 300 on TV. Looks like maybe the break has done them both the world of good. And I would expect to see both these players in contention many, many more times this year. There's a little bit of professionalism being shown here by Paul Trotter. He has pride in his game, pride in his performance. He wants to finish off as well as he can. Can't win the match, but he wants to finish off as well as he can. Give this big crowd as much entertainment as possible. I like to see that from a bowler. You know, some consideration for the crowd, give them the best entertainment possible. Here's the final shot of the match. Leads us off 10.
Now, a lot of people ask me, what's the best way of throwing a strike? Should I just hit the middle pin? Well, technically, that's correct. But you shouldn't try to hit it straight on. Right now, with that ball where it's positioned now, if you hit it straight on, that middle pin is actually going to split the two pins behind it, go straight back, and that's not going to be able to take out those pins in the corner. So usually, you're going to leave a split, which involves two pins on either side of the line.
Tournament, the 2009 South Australian Youth Classic, is a very long pattern. It's 45 feet in length, but the oil volume is not that high. It's only 23 units, and as a result, the players have been finding that the condition, the track, especially through the track area, has been breaking down very quickly.
How do bowlers get into this tournament?
Well, generally, you'll find most disabled bowlers bowl in the league in their local centres. And from there, they'll apply to go into the state tournaments where we have a selection process. And then from that, the state teams are selected and we go to the national tournaments.
And are all states represented in this tournament?
At present, all states are represented, except for South Australia and Tasmania at the present.
I believe you have wheelchair participants, also blind people as well. And please explain to us, what are the different grades of blind people?
Okay, this tournament comprises all sorts of disabilities, anything from intellectual through to blindness, deafness, and that. We have in this tournament is also the roll-off for the national blind team, which is to be held in Asia in the next 2 years. There's three categories of blind bowlers. We have B1s, B2s and B3s. B3s basically have a little bit of sight. They can see probably three quarters of the way down the lane. B2s, that sight's reduced to probably a quarter of the way with a lot less peripheral vision. And B1s are actually totally blind. And to actually ensure that they are totally blind, they actually wear goggles.
And how long has this tournament been running for?
This is the third year it's been running for now. This is probably the best year we've had so far. We've actually got two people from South Australia. We've also got two people from Tasmania as well. So we're doing quite well in getting people from all over the country coming around.
What sort of averages do you expect to have on this tournament?
Well, we've just finished the first qualifying block for today, and the highest average we've had is 240 by a left-hander named Dwayne. He's bowling pretty well, but I'm expecting maybe a house average of about 200 for our scratch boys and maybe about 190 for our scratch girls today.
And what age group are these youth bowlers?
Well, I heard the youngest bowler we have today is 9, and obviously the oldest bowler is 18, being you have to be under the age of 18 as at the 1st of January this year.
Okay, and what is the actual purpose of this tournament? Is to encourage more bowlers into the sport?
Absolutely. The idea is to get beginner bowlers, intermediate and even advanced bowlers under the age of 18 to actually come down and have a bit of a bowl. It's a one-day tournament, and they've just got the ability to make a few friends, have a good time and maybe even win a bit of money.
Welcome to this week's edition of the 10 Pin Bowling Show. I'm with Australian wonder bowler Jason Belmonte here in Sydney. Jason, welcome to the show.
Mate, thank you for coming out here, yeah. I appreciate it.
We've heard you've had some great results worldwide with your 10-pin bowling. Can you tell us a little bit about your 10-pin bowling and how it's actually going?
Yeah, well, basically the last 12 months has been, you know, a stellar year for me. I've done so well around the world, and then to cap it off by winning on the PBA Tour and then to win the PBA Rookie of the Year Award as well was just phenomenal. It's definitely going to be the benchmark for my career in terms of results in one calendar year, and it's going to be hard to beat. But you know what? I think in order for anyone to get better, you've got to set pretty tough and pretty high goals, and that's what I'm going to try and do.
You're also now the Rookie of the Year with the PBA, which is a mammoth task, and you've just blown them away in America with 10-pin bowling.
Mate, it was really, really emotional for me, and a very proud moment. You only get one crack at being a rookie. You get your first year out there, and to have done so well and to have won a tournament on my first year out there as well was just, you know, a dream come true. Like I said, normally I can talk about anything, but I was just speechless after that that win.
The match is won. Now the interest is, can George Flingos throw two more strikes for the first ever 300 on the 10-pin bowling show?
Folks, you are watching Australia's number one ranked male bowler, Seeing him go about his business for number 11. Lovely shot.
Flush again.
Fantastic shot.
Absolutely flush again. Cannot throw it any better than that.
I've never bowled 300 with noise, so can we clap this one in? Let's hope I keep it on the lane.
Is he hamming up the crowd?
Well,
can't clap it in.
He was serious.
He is. Now, he's either extremely nervous or extremely confident.
But hold on to your hats, folks. This is number 12 for the perfect game of 300.
There it is!
He loves it. George Palingos. Not too sure how many he's shot now, but he's shot a perfect game 300 to be the 2009 Melbourne 10-pin Cup champion. And welcome viewers back to the 10 Pin Bowling Show. This is the New South Wales State League Big Clash coming to you from 10 Pin City at Lidcombe in New South Wales. Just coincidentally, Brenton, it's the third year anniversary for the 10 Pin Bowling Show, and boy, haven't we had a lot happen in the 3 years we've been around.
We have indeed. Matt Riley going through the nose on that particular hit. Interesting that the third anniversary coincides with two birthdays of the commentary team here, both on the same day. Just a shame the years don't coincide.
Oh, nice work. The 24th of March.
Great day for commentators.
Something like that.
Great spare there from Matt Riley.
And yes, who could forget? There's been a few things happened in the 3 years of commentary. We've had Jason Belmonte winning his first PBA Tour win. We've had George Palingos throwing the first televised 300. Had a lot of highlights in the first 3 years of the 10 Pin Bowling Show. Daniel Webb, your second shot now. This will be the sixth frame.
Much better shot, that one. Still a hair high, only still just a touch tentative.
But he does have to clean up here. He's got to do the team thing. See if he can maintain the lead for Inter Bowl. Done well. Teammates appreciating that.
It's a tough format, this. You only get two frames maximum to contribute to your team. And you don't have time to adjust. Just got to get out there and get lined up and throw good shots really quickly.
Jason for his second shot. Now, both of his shots have gone high. Didn't like that off the hand at all. He's taken eight, though. No splits, which is a good thing. The last thing you need to do is get further behind.
And at this point in time, they certainly need to keep marking, because the current 13-pin deficit, there's not a lot of time left to pick that up.
No, and should the next bowler up for Inter Bowl, which is Sam Cooley, if he throws a strike, they go to 23 down. And that's a heck of a hole to get out of with three frames to come.
That it is.
Sam Cooley through a strike with his first frame. See if he can add to that tally.
Ooh, That's tight.
Way inside.
Nearly got the hugest break there. Did not like it off the hand at all.
Oh boy. The whole centre just about held their breath on that one. Not knocking it over the required amount of degrees to tip that pin over. How many degrees is that, coincidentally?
It's 11 degrees from memory.
It's not a bad memory. Spare time for Sam Cooley. He's gone strike spare. Good contribution to the team. And in a bowl. Hold on to that 22-pin lead.
Now, Glenn Rowland needs to make a better shot than his previous effort. Yeah, that's out the window too. Glenn really... in this match, I think he's just thrown a couple of really bad shots. He just looks like he's got a major timing issue happening here, and he needs to get lined up on this shot. big time.
Yup. Sped it up. But that's the last we'll see of Glenn Rowland for this game.
And by the look of him, Glenn thinks, thank goodness for that.
Oh, boy. It's an open and a spare. It hasn't been his game.
Not at all.
Dale Fitzgerald. Throws another one. That's the two flush of shots we've seen him throw. Very, very good contribution.
Sensational shot, this one. Tight line. Look at that.
Mm. Beautiful. High fives all around for Interval.
Now, Andrew really needs to get something happening.
Oh, boy.
Four. Ten Pin City, but they really just haven't looked in sync in this match at all.
That ball really bit up at the back end.
They've only had two strikes in nine frames, and one of those was a Brooklyn, so...
Great spare, though. That's exactly how you need to spare those. Andrew Lloyd fitting the ball right in between the two and the seven. Good job.
Now, Kevin Webb, if he can throw a strike here, that's pretty much game over.
Just about game, set, match. Oh, look out!
Ooh, okay. Looked up to the side. Was there a little bit of a distraction there? Okay, we have the plastic ball out again in Kevin's hand. He'll be able to make shoot the spare.
Oh.
Whoa. And Ten Pin City have just had new life breathed into them.
And it was virtue of this shot here. Unlucky as it may seem, ball rolling up just enough to clip the three pin on its own. Now Glenn Loader, if there's anybody you'd want the ball in the hands. It's Glenn. Not the preferred way going about it. Throwing the hit pin across, cleaning out the 4-7. Gets the carry. Fist pump.
Tell you what, if he can throw a double, all of a sudden, it's just a little bit of pressure on Christian Perdue. He needs to make the double.
Oh, but this guy, he's been in this position before. He's represented Australia on several occasions. He knows what it takes.
Oh dear, that's down real early. This has been a common leave this match. Really been a common leave this match. Every time it's been when the ball has just read the mid lane too early.
Yes.
I'm wondering if the heads are starting to break down a little bit.
Oh, I think you could be right there. There's going to be a few bowlers having trouble from this point onwards. But he takes two. And the Ten Pin City team have thrown a game of 179. But unfortunately for them, you would think it's not going to be enough. Christian Perdue needs six pins in two balls. Don't think that's going to be too much of a problem.
I think I'd quite easily bet the house on this one.
And mine too.
Ooh, tried to throw it through the beak.
Eight down, it's enough. Interball gained another point. It's all about sparing and throwing the best shot for the field ball. He quite comfortably knows it's enough. Takes out the hard case plastic. Throwing cross lane.
Oof. Makes a spare, and I would say he'll make an adjustment on this shot to see if he can find, you know, the right adjustment to make, because you know, the ball is starting to hook early. Everyone's having the problem with the ball reading the mid lane too early, like the heads are drying out. Needs to make an adjustment.
And a great shot to finish from Christian Perdue. Inner ball. Finished with 194. The Ten Pin City's 179. Inner ball. Go 4-2 up.
Thanks for your company today, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Good luck in bowling.